Well, God bless and welcome to Hope Church Online on our online platform, whether you're watching Facebook or on YouTube. I have four quick things I'd love to share with you. And let's get going. Number one, we're currently meeting at number 319 Spencer Road in Thornley, Western Australia, if you're in Western Australia. And that's our, as known as the Thornley Church of Christ building. We are commandeering and using this space at 4 p.m. for a 4 p.m. service. Until God willing, one day we believe that we will land a building in the promised land that God has for us. And we're on a pilgrimage to see that come to pass in Jesus' mighty name. So if you get a chance to meet us in person and to come join an in-person service, it's at 4 p.m. 319 Spencer Road, Thornley, or just Google Hope Church in Google Maps and it'll come straight up. Great. Number two is that we believe that the online platform is a supplement, not a main course meal. Why would I say that? Because in a main course meal, when you're at the restaurant, you can smell the aroma of the cooking, you can be in the atmosphere of the people, and you can experience what the restaurant was designed for. And Acts chapter 2, at the very end, it says that they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, the breaking of bread, meeting in the temple, and meeting at the table. And that is the model of the church of Jesus Christ. And that's how the early apostles started the church. And so we want to follow that model. So we believe that the temple, what we would call the ecclesia, the body of Christ, has an aroma to it and has an atmosphere to it that you cannot translate through an online platform. However, in saying that, we believe that the online platform is powerful and has a significant place itself. But we still always say, if you can be here in person, we would love to see you and be a part of that. Number three, we believe that giving is an essential part of the Christian walk. Two reasons. Number one, it is the obligation of the Christian believer and of the journey of the Christian walk to give into the house of the Lord to see the kingdom of God propagated from heaven to earth through the body of Christ and through the house of the Lord. So we believe that the obligation and the responsibility as a Christian is to see the kingdom of God and see the house of Jesus Christ, the house of the Lord, risen in finance and risen so it can achieve kingdom work in the earth. So that's number one. Number two is also that the Bible declares that the root, the love of money, is the root of evil. And so the love of money has a place in our heart that it really shouldn't have. And sometimes we can idolize the finance where really we just go, God, there's finance in, finance out, finance in, finance out. When we hear in the spirit, we release in the natural. And so when we receive in the finance, we release out in the finance. And so we are giving people because we want to flow out of us so something can flow into us. Blessing flowing in, blessing flowing out. And we want to keep that river flowing in our lives and that practice as a spiritual walk. So I encourage you that giving is an important and essential responsibility and a faith journey of each and every single believer. So giving options are here at the bottom and you can go ahead and do that as the service is progressing. But I believe that it's an essential part of the Christian walk. Number four, we believe that the community, just as I mentioned prior in Acts chapter 2 at the very end, about the temple and the table. Now let's talk about the table part. We believe that connect groups are the essential lifeblood and the heartbeat of the soul of the church, because that's where you get to meet and build relationships and talk over the things of the kingdom of God and over the messages and apply that in your own life with other believers. And that's where the iron sharpens the iron and we can grow in faith. So we have connect groups running every fortnight and you can go on our website, hopechurchonline.com.au. You can have a look at many other things on the website, but connect groups are on there and I would encourage you to go have a look at a connect group, go reach out, join a connect group and be a part of the body of Christ where we can pull apart the message, apply it in our lives, grow with each other, pray with each other and build the Christian walk. So in saying all of that, they're the four things, but I encourage you, be here on a Sunday afternoon if you can. We love you and we believe that God has a great things in store for your life and for our life. Hope Church, hope is on the rise. See you during the service.
patience, keeping up appearances, cause there ain't no impressing you. You said don't act like it's
harder. Why don't you stand with us? Who is ready to praise our God this afternoon? Amen? Who knows that praise precedes the victory? Yes? Come on. So we're going to put ourselves in a position of praise this afternoon. If you're watching online, I want to welcome you to stand with us. We're going to praise our God. Amen? Come on. Woo! Let's sing.
I got this revelation. It's a reason that I praise. It's a celebration. Every time I hear a name, I've got this revelation of all you've done for me. You set my soul on fire.
Come on, church.
It's the reason that I can't wait. Join in the praise, lift up a song with the angels and saints. Ain't got no time to hesitate, cause I'm learning just the same. I've found freedom, oh, 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 oh. This is freedom. When I found you, I found freedom. This is freedom.
Here we go.
My path has been erased. It's more than just a feeling. And I won't hold back. I'm patient to get to the house. Join in the praise. Lift up a song with the angels and sing. Ain't got time to hesitate.
Ain't no rock,
ain't no rock, gonna cry in my place.
Truth in this house.
Amen.
As the word of the Lord, he's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, so we can take him at his word. Amen. 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 Hey, go ahead and grab your seat. It's good to have you all in the house this afternoon. Good evening, everybody. How are we? Awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. We're going to come into a time of communion this afternoon. And it's a powerful thing we do. Scripture's clear in Corinthians that as often as we gather, as much as we can, we do this in remembrance of him. The blood representing what was spilled on the cross that poured out for your salvation and redemption in mine. The body that was broken, the bread. For what took place, that we might be healed. Communion is something that you just slip by very easily.
but it's one of the rare and only few liturgies that we do. A liturgy is like practice, Christian practice, that you do in the house. And you don't get many of them in the house. You don't actually get many of them in the form of a congregation, in the form of the temple. But communion's one of them. And so communion's quite powerful. It's quite unique because it's the only, one of the only elements, liturgies that we have, practices that we have, that actually dates all the way back to what Christ instilled himself with his own hands and with his own mouth. And if he could do it, and if he said we do it, it's good enough for us. My encouragement this afternoon is, as we take of our communion, to remember Jesus. When I say that, it sounds odd saying that, remember Jesus, because we're in a church. But it's very easy to come to church and not even think about him. It's easy to come to a house and not come for him in the house. It's easy to go to a church and it's just dry. It's no life. You got to ask the question, you know, Jesus is the life giver. He gave us new life. We are reborn in him. The whole conversation with him and Nicodemus. So we need life in this house. We need life in our lives. We need to be reborn constantly. And Hebrews says that, Hebrews 4:14, we can come to our great high priest, to the throne of grace, and find mercy. I love that word, mercy. Lately, I've gravitated to that word, mercy. Have mercy on me, Lord. You know, our nation, our globe, it needs mercy now more than ever before. We need the mercy of the Lord. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to look at the news and think, wow, this is we're decaying rapidly now. It's exponential. And now more than ever, we need his mercy. His grace is abundant. It's always there, but we need his mercy. Have mercy on me, O Lord. You know, there was two others on the cross when Jesus was crucified, and one asked, have mercy on me, remember me. It doesn't take a lot to think where you should have been and where you could have been, had the mercy of the Lord not fallen on you and given you a second chance, me included, that none of us should boast but in Christ alone. Amen. I think lately, I don't know why, but lately I've been thanking the Lord for my salvation. I think I've been thanking him that he saved me. Because it's easy to think, you know, I'm saved, done. It's all cool. It's great. Do you really, like, are you really thankful for what he did? Do you realize the gravity of what took place? That on a cross, judgment meets with mercy. Judgment flows in one way. Jesus in the center, mercy flows out of the other. He poured mercy on you and me. I think sometimes we just forget how thankful we should be. And to be reborn in him means he is a life giver. And it's only by his mercy that we can be here today. I want to take communion with you together as my brothers and sisters in this house. Maybe we could just be thankful and remember all that he's done in our lives. Is that okay? Amen. Why don't you stand with us? I preached at another house this morning, and on the way home, I just started singing, you know, turn your eyes upon Jesus, you remember? And I thought, just for a minute, can we just maybe declare that and sing that together? Because sometimes you can just forget. It's just simple. Just turn your eyes. Just look at him in your heart. Close your eyes. Look at him. Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus and look full in his wonderful face. Come on, let his mercy fall on you and just forget about the things of this world and the things Jesus will.
fleeting in the light of His glory and grace.
Come on, let's sing that one more time as the body. Let's believe. And the finisher of our faith, Jesus, come take the glory.
Look full in His wonderful.
Come on, and the things of this world, yes,
and the
how they will grow near. Let it fade away. We'll grow strange. Jesus, come on.
And the things of the world
will grow strangely. If you don't have a communion emblem, lift your hand and an usher will come and bring one to you now. But if you've got the body, what would represent? Come on, hold it up in your hand with me. Lord, what represents your body in this house? You said to do this in remembrance of me. Today, Lord, we remember you, Jesus. We remember you, Jesus. We thank you for your body as we take it together and remember the sacrifice you made for us that we might be saved, set free, and healed. In Jesus' mighty name, let's eat together. Father, we lift up what represents your blood, the blood of the Lamb of God that was slain for the sin of the world. That we might call upon the name, and those that call upon the name will find healing and redemption and salvation. Jesus, we thank you for your blood that was shed upon a cross for our salvation, that we might know you. We do this in remembrance of you, in Jesus' mighty name. Let's drink together. Come on, let's worship together. Come on, let's call upon the name of the Lord. Let's see something happen in the house today. I didn't come for church. I came for a revival. Let's go. Come on.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Father, we ask that your glory would fall in this place. As we praise and as we worship and as we lift up your name, as we honor your name, Father. We pray that you would meet us in power, that miracles would break out, that healings would take place, that lives would be touched and changed as we welcome you with our presence, as we welcome your presence with our praise, Father, with our worship. Father, I ask right now that you would soften every heart. That every mouth, that every heart, that every soul would be positioned to worship you, Father. that we would worship with the saints. That we wouldn't worship to hear ourselves, Father, but we would worship seeking your face. Because you are worthy of it all. You are worthy of every minute. You are worthy of every word. You are worthy of every part of our lives. Why don't you lift your hands? Father, we ask that you would bless us with your glory as we worship you today. Why don't you start thanking him? I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Father. I thank you, Holy Spirit. Why don't you thank him out of your mouth? Why don't we give him adoration? We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Holy Spirit. You are good to us. You're a good, good Father. You're our provider. You meet every need. You are holy. You are worthy. You are glorified. You are honored. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, God. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, God. Holy Jesus. Holy God. Holy God. Holy God. Let's sing.
Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus.
So worthy, God.
You deserve praise.
Every single bit of worthy me, is worthy of it all.
You sing it out.
Worthy is your name.
Oh, you deserve it all.
Praise.
Worthy is.
Sing it again.
Worthy is your name. Jesus, you deserve praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus.
That's right. He does. Let's sing it out. Worthy is his name.
Worthy is your name, Jesus.
Jesus, you deserve praise. Worthy is
deserve the praise. Worthy is your name.
Come on, church, let's sing it to him.
Worthy is your name. Is worthy of every praise.
Again,
worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve praise. Yes, you do, God. Yes, you do, God. You're worthy of every praise. You're worthy of every praise.
Come on, church,
you are worthy of every praise. He is worthy of your praise. He is worthy of your praise. Let's sing it out. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name.
Keep singing at church. Keep singing, church. He loves it when we worship him. Keep singing. Our heart and our lips cry out. We will worship him for eternity. Let's keep worshiping.
He is worthy. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is the name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. He is worthy of all our praise. He is worthy of all our praise. There's not a word that we should hold back from him, 'cause he is everything and he is worthy of it all.
Come on, he is worthy.
You're worthy to be praised. You're worthy to be glorified. And we honor you. We honor you, God. Sing out, come on. Won't you worship him? Won't you worship him? Oh, you love him when we worship you. Let's worship him for who he is. Not for what he does, but who he is.
Come on.
You are King of Kings and Lord of Lords, my Savior. Come on, he's the Savior. Oh, you are worthy, God. Yes, you are worthy, Lord. Come on, he is worthy to be praised and adored in every situation. Let's sing it again. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of... Sing it again, come on. Death couldn't hold him. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of sin. Come on, death. And death could not hold you, you devil before you, you silenced the bonds of sin. Hey, come on, the heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. Come on, you have no rival.
No, he doesn't.
You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign.
He reigns right here. Come on. Yours is the kingdom, God. Yours is the glory.
Yours is the name above all names.
What a powerful name it is.
What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ.
Come on, it is a powerful name.
What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Come on, sing it out. It's a powerful name.
What a powerful name. Sing it again. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. Oh, it's a powerful name. What a powerful name. It's not a weak name. It's not a weak name. Come on. It's powerful. It's powerful. Come on, his name is powerful. The name of Jesus is powerful. There is power in your name. There is power in your name. There is power in your name, Jesus. Why don't you cry out his name? Cry out Jesus. Cry out Jesus. 'Cause when his name is lifted high, every chain is gonna break, every barrier will move in the name.
Why don't you sing out Jesus over your situation, church? Why don't you cry out Jesus when you don't know what to pray? Why don't you cry out Jesus when you don't know how to say, when you don't know how to face what you're facing? All you need to say is, Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Your will, Father, to come forth. Your will to be prepared, Father, in Jesus' name. Jesus, we love you. Jesus, we honor you. Jesus, your name is powerful. Jesus, your name breaks chains. Jesus, your name casts out devils. Jesus, your name brings healing. It's your name, Jesus. It's your name, Jesus. Your name. Jesus, that's his name, that's his name. His name is Yeshua, his name is Yeshua. Your name is Yeshua,
Yeshua.
Yeshua.
the name above every other name, Yeshua HaMashiach. That dead are raised back to life. That name of Jesus, the name of Jesus is not just the name. There's power in the name that should the name of Jesus be applied, and the blood, that's where things start to change. That's where church services turn into revivals, when the blood starts to pour out, when the Spirit starts to descend and the anointing hits the room and the Spirit starts to stir our hearts. I said it before, I didn't come here for a service. I came here to be marked by the Holy Spirit. I want to read such a powerful portion of Scripture about our beautiful Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It says this, Philippians 2. I pray that you would know it. If you don't, here we go. Although he was God, we're talking about Jesus. Let these words of the Scriptures of the Lord sink in your heart. Close your eyes. Receive it. This is his word. Although he was God, he didn't think of himself equal to God, as some people think. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges and he took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died the criminal's death on the cross. In doing so, therefore, God elevated him to the place of the highest honor, and he gave him a name that would be above every other name, that at that name of Jesus Christ, at the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, every knee should bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue confess that he is Lord to the glory of God the Father. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. And I encourage you this afternoon, we could have service or we could have power of the Holy Spirit in this house. For he is Lord. For he is Lord. He's the name above every other name. He's the King of Kings. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. I'm just sensing something in my spirit here. Okay. In my heart, what I hear in my heart is this, that I sense that there is almost like a division in the room. Some are just desperate to cling to Jesus. And some forgot what that was like. Breakthrough always starts. Catherine Kuhlman, a woman of God, used to say this, breakthrough starts on your knees. What she meant by that is breakthrough starts in prayer. We're not done yet. I want to declare the name of Jesus so rock hard in this house that every resistance, every distraction, every weight that you might be feeling in your life today, I'm praying that the name of Jesus is going to demolish the living daylights out of it. Because I want to put the name of the Lord to the test. That's what he says. Test me and I'll show you that I won't open up the windows of heaven. So I want to test you, Lord. We say the name above every other name. Watch something happen in this house this afternoon. I tell you that the name of Jesus is not a name to be played with. He is the Lord God Almighty, to be revered and honored and exalted. So I believe in my heart. Let's just worship him for a few more minutes. And I think people that are hungry, watch something shift in the atmosphere in the next minute. For he is Lord. Yes, you are Jesus, for he is Lord, and he
my Jesus today. Come on. That every knee, come on, like Philippians says, every knee.
That every knee shall bow.
And every tongue confess. Jesus. Come on, let's put the faith in this house. Let's go, guys. I speak to every bondage. I speak to the spirit of depression. I speak to weight, bondage and oppression, the yoke. In the name of Jesus, your bondage is loose. I break it. Healing and restoration in the name of Jesus. Come on. Purposelessness, I demand that you leave in the name of Jesus. In the authority of the name of Jesus Christ, be healed, be set free. Every demonic oppression, lift. Lift up in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, we thank you for your power. Amen. You carry Jesus into our hearts, and I thank you for that. Church, you have to understand that there is this, if you have accepted Jesus in your heart, and that the strongest authority and power of the risen King lives within us, desperate to get out of us. Mark 16, commission, go and lay hands, just go, just get out and do it, just go, lay hands and do it. Why? Because the Spirit of living God wants to flow out of you and touch someone's life, but we limit ourselves because my week is more important than him. No, he is more important than the whole week, man. He is more important than my finances. He is more important than my emotions. He's more important than my marriage. I don't put my marriage above my Lord.
Amen.
I actually put my Lord and the calling and the giftings and everything above, and I lead a family to say this is what it looks like to sacrifice to the Lord as a family. I don't put my finances above. I put him above my finances, and I just say, you know what, finances, you go to the Lord. You bow to him. For Jehovah Jireh shall provide.
Amen.
We need to put the Lord to the test. And that's not arrogance, that's submission, and to validate, show my God's alive. The same power that did raise Christ 2,000 years later is wanting to flow out of you. You are so valuable in the kingdom of God. You have no idea the potential within you. Should we just get out of our bubble and lay hands on someone? Watch the Spirit of the living God move through you. Don't put what you're going through above him. Put him above it.
Amen.
And let him move through it.
Amen.
And testify to the goodness of our God. There's a mighty church rising. You are rising. We are rising. Because God is equipping us and steering this house to start to lay hands on someone and get it out of you. Holy Spirit. I want to take up the offering. And usually I'd say, grab a seat. I don't want to do that. I want to stir you today. I want to encourage you today that we're going to give in a second. Some of you do it all the electronic ways. I love that. That's fine. I want to encourage us. This is the year to go, but this is in an element of go that has to be sacrificed. You know, the Bible says give a sacrifice of praise. What does that mean? I've got to lay something down to praise him. I've got to sacrifice something. Why would you use the word sacrifice? We're going to give something to him. And we're going to come into a place in the context of this service to give our tithe and our offering. And I encourage us, church, put him to the test. Let's start to testify the goodness of God. Come on. Let's start to testify that my God, Jehovah Jireh, that name still means something. That name's still active.
Yeah.
It's still applied. Jehovah Jireh will provide.
Amen.
And give a sacrifice of praise. Give a sacrifice of our offering today. Lord, I pray that today would be a sacrificial giving. A sacrificial giving to testify. We need more testimonies that God's moving, that God is on the move. We need more testimonies. So Lord, use us today. Take our offering, Lord. Let it be a sacrifice to you, that you would use that and that you would use us in obedience, and we can testify that you work wonders and miracles in our lives. We give you honor and praise for what we're about to give. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. 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 Hey, go ahead and grab a seat. Can we keep the giving slide up for a minute? If you want to give in the different formats, you can do so. You can. So we've started to put into our services testimony services. In the next few months, we've scheduled in a few testimonies to testify to the goodness of God. And so I'm publicly saying, if you have a testimony, come talk to me after. As time progresses, if you've got something that you feel that you could testify and give glory to God, please do it. The buckets are on your right. Sorry, pass them down to your left. Sorry. But we're going to have testimony services because we're going to start getting, I want to get old school, start testifying that Jesus is on the move, Jesus is doing something, His love never fails, His goodness never ends. Amen. Amen. We had a prayer time on Tuesday. Can I steal 30 seconds just to bubble a little bit? Good. We had a prayer time on Thursday and I shared a prophetic image that I had to those that were praying on Tuesdays. For those that would like to know, we pray on Tuesdays 9 a.m. You're welcome to join us. Everyone's welcome to join us. Fallen Church of Christ, some of their guys come and join us as well. We pray together. I think that's powerful. It's unity. That's the body of Christ. The Lord reminded me of when the girls were born. And the Lord said, it was so beautiful. Because the Lord said, I remember being in the room when Kira was giving birth to both of the girls. And in some ways it looked chaotic, because it was, anyone understands what the birthing process is, it's how you women can do that. You are a gift from God. And the Lord reminded me of when Kira gave birth, and it was peaceful and all that. But the moment when one of the girls came out, it was the moment. And the Lord reminded me, it was somewhat painful. I was watching Kira just in agony and pain, and my heart's breaking for her, but yet you're joyful at the same time, and it's all that. And the Lord said to me that hope is birthing something new. I speak to this to you prophetically, just hear me out. Holy Spirit. And the Lord is saying that He's been saying there's a birthing process taking place, and you've got two options. Look at the chaos around you, or look what's coming out. Look at the chaos. Look what's not there. Look what you do have. Look at the natural, or look at what's coming supernaturally. I encourage us, church, do not look at the extremities. Don't look at the surroundings. And look at what the Lord is doing. Forget about the external. Forget about the surrounding effects. Forget about who's here or not here. Whatever that. Forget about that. Look at what the Lord is doing. And something's being birthed. Something's coming. We're in the process of birthing pains. I sense this like a birthing pains. So keep our eyes on Jesus and on the Spirit of the living God, and we'll be fine. My favorite prayer, one of my favorite songs at the moment that you hear us pray, sing it all the time. Lord, clean my hands. Who can ascend to the hill of the Lord? He that has clean hands and a pure heart. Just clean my hands, Lord. Just clean my hands. Wash my hands, Lord Jesus, because I'm going to lay hands on someone. That's why Mark 6 said my hands. And just keep my heart pure, Lord. Good. Awesome. Praise God. All right. Enough of that. Turn your eyes to the screens as we get into church news.
Well, good afternoon, Hope Church, and what a beautiful Sunday it is to be in the house of the Lord. I'm going to throw some quick announcements out at you, and we're going to get straight into this. Church, if you're interested in joining a Connect group, we want to encourage you to head to hopechurchonline.com connectgroup.au to find where your nearest connect group is. Church, we have all our giving options available on the screen. Push pay, cash envelopes, buckets now. We're back to the buckets. It's awesome. And we have updated our direct debit details. So get on to that. Church, we are on all social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. And that is all from me. Enjoy the rest of your service, and we will catch you next week.
Thank you, Ben. Awesome. Okay. Well, before we get into the word, and I'm excited about the word, we've got a few things. Can I just give some announcements, please, that weren't on the church news? Number one, for those that are part of the prayer ministry batch, our first general meeting is here at 7 p.m. tomorrow night. So please be here, and we'll go through it. It won't be a long time. I promise you it'll be like half an hour to an hour. And so 7 p.m. here at the building. That'll be with us and with Matt and Sharon. Great. We are doing, and I don't know if we have the artwork for it yet, but we are doing Easter in the round. We're going to try it in here. So we thought, how are we going to do it? We don't know yet. We're still figuring all that out. So, but we're going to do Easter in the round, and we're going to do it in the middle here, and we're only allowing a certain amount of seats, given the capacity and the way we're going to do it. So this week we're going to put on the website that you could register for it. I think we're only doing one service, is that correct? Yep. So we're only doing one service, and we're going to do an Easter in the round Friday night service, and that's from 5 to 8 p.m. We're going to try and load it up with food and finger foods and all the bits and pieces around it. It's going to be a fun night. And I just think it's a Friday night, good night out. Let's go, let's have some fun, boogie, you know, in the round, and we'll have a good time. Cool? So this week, you'll start seeing it all on the social media. We live on the social media. That's the way of the future. No one reads the newspaper anymore. Everyone looks at it on social media. So keep an eye on that, and it will be up and running this week, and you can start to register. It's all free, but just register seats. That way we've got limited seating. Cool? Great. Last but not least, we have to say goodbye to someone. Yeah, it's a goodbye time. So it's her last week here. She's going to move down south to Bunbury. Can you please welcome up Tess Anderson as we're going to pray for her? Come on. You look beautiful, Tess. Who loves the Anderson family? Good family. It feels like you and me. I'd be a bit shocked if you didn't do that. So we just want to pray for Tess. We want to thank her. Tess ran our welcome and ushers department for some time, and she did an amazing job in an awesome season, and she is going off to be an audiologist in Bunbury. I'm just praying that the Lord will call that back in Jesus' name, you know. She can come back to the house, but it's just for 2 years, correct? At this stage. The contract's 2 years, and we pray that it wouldn't be renewed. Jesus, and if the Lord, whatever the Lord wants to do, I'm not speaking against it, it's whatever the Lord wants to do. Shit, I'm on the lover. Cool. But can you stretch your hands to Tess? Tess, you want to say anything quickly? Yeah, thank the RSL club. Go for it.
So I've been privileged to be at this church for a long time, and so a lot of people have fed into me, and so I'm really, really grateful to everybody. I could name every name, but I'll be here forever. So yeah, I just really wanted to thank everybody for what they've done in my life.
We love her, we love it. Pastor Kira, come on. We're going to lay hands on her. Let's bless her out and release her out of hope into the care of the Lord. Father, we just lift up Tess right now. We thank you, Lord, for the heart of service and the heart of a servant heart that she has. Lord, she just wants to see your will be done in her life. And we thank you for this window of opportunity in Bunbury that has come up for her audiology contract. Lord, we thank you that it's not by coincidence. Nothing ever is. So, Lord, we bless her. We release her in the mighty name of Jesus. And we ask, Holy Spirit, be with her all of her days as she goes down there and she starts a new life for the next few years. Lord, we thank you that she'll be able to come back at whenever time she wants, and we'll have her back in the house. And Lord, we just look forward to seeing the testimonies of things in her life that you are doing great things. Lord, we pray a blessing over her in Jesus' mighty name. Everybody said.
So it's a second prayer. Everyone raise your hands. Lord, we thank you for Tess, and Father, we thank you that in this season you have been preparing her, And like Pastor Matt said, that this opportunity is actually an opportunity for ministry. As a Father, right now, I ask that you have been, as you have been preparing her, Father, that you would anoint her and that you would commission her for the ministry that you have for her, Father. That her desire to be involved in the industry that she's in, it was not birthed from herself, Lord, but you placed it there. And you are now releasing her into the workplace for your ministry, Lord. So we just pray right now that there would be a protection around Tess as she goes and activates her calling, Lord, in the ministry that you've called her to, in the workplace, Father, which might seem like a wilderness season for her, Lord, but it's a season where her foundations are being set, Lord. So, Father, we just pray right now that you would speak to her clearly, that you would give her wisdom and direction, and that you would bring people around her that would give her godly counsel, Father, as she steps into this new season and into this new ministry that you have for her. In Jesus' name we said, amen.
Give her a big God bless you.
Cool.
Great. All right, you ready for the word? Come on, let's get into the house this evening. You ready for the word? Good. Lord, we pray that your word would be anointed, that you would have your hand upon the word, and that it would do what it's sent out to do, change our lives. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Come on, give a big hand and God bless you to Cassandra Caccetta.
Good afternoon, everyone. How are we doing? Very good. Am I in the center? Is this the middle? Reese, are we good? Don't need to move it. A little bit this way. Look, I'm talking spoilers about urgent faith this afternoon. So if this is urgently needs to be in the center, I will do that as part of the demonstration of what I'm doing. How is everyone this afternoon? Amazing. It is a really big privilege and honor to be able to be speaking again. This is my second time preaching the word at Hope. So again, I just want to thank Pastor Matt, Pastor Kira, Pastor Ray and Pastor Pat for giving me the opportunity to do this. I don't take it lightly. I know the weight of what it is, and it's just such a privilege and an honor to be able to do it. Before we jump into the word, I have to expose Pastor Ray a little bit. So I'm standing there, and then I go to sit down, and I feel this little tap on my shoulder. And it's Pastor Ray, and I lean in, and I said, "What's up?" He goes, "I have to repent." I said, "Oh, what's up?" He goes, "I'm hungry. I want food." Who's hungry? Physically, but for the word. Yeah, come on. Who's more hungry from the word than for food? Yeah, come on. Great. Love that. Beautiful. We're all on the same page. That's good. All right, I'm going to pray. God, I thank you for this afternoon. I thank you for the honor and the privilege that it is to be able to worship you together, to be together in community. God, I pray that as your word is released, that it would just land on good soil, that our hearts would be open and receptive, that it would be more of you and less of me in Jesus' name. Amen. Awesome. So, like I said, this afternoon, I want to talk about urgent faith. This is something that God's really been stirring my heart on, about what does it mean to have a faith that is urgent. And when I say urgent, I know that our minds can automatically go to frantic or doing more or hurry up, let's go and do the next thing. And so I just want to preface by saying that's not what I mean by urgent faith. Urgent faith doesn't mean frantic faith, anxious faith, or unsettled faith. It just means that it gets number one priority and attention in our life. So the opposite of urgent means is trivial, which means of little value and importance. So I'm not speaking to the pace of our faith. I'm speaking to the importance that we put on our faith, because everyone is in different seasons. Some people can sprint, some people can crawl, some people can run, but it's not about the pace. I'm speaking to the value and what it looks like in our lives practically when we're putting what our faith should look like when we put it as number one priority. Is that all right? Awesome. So just some questions to get us thinking is, firstly, what value does your faith have to you? And I know that that's a pretty basic, pretty simple question, but I think it's a healthy one to be asking ourselves. What value does our faith have to you? And, you know, you might automatically straight away say, well, the highest value, of course, it's my faith. It's number one. And if that's the case, I think we actually need to look at practically, if it is number one in our lives, does the fruit of our life show that that's the case? Because we don't want to be people that just say words. We want to be people that bear fruit, where our actions match the things we say. So if we are saying, yes, Lord, you are number one in my life, my faith is number one priority, then we want to make sure that our lives are reflecting that and that the fruit that is coming out of our lives reflects the position of our faith. Does that make sense? Cool. Let's jump into the word. I'm going to be reading from Matthew 8, verses 5 to 13 in the ESV. What version, out of curiosity, does everybody read? NIV. Ooh, okay. Amplified. Ooh. I love the Amplified Bible. I do. But I feel like, you know, if I wanted to read it that way, I'd just get like the synonym thing up, and then just, because there's a lot of brackets and commas. No judgment. Everyone read whatever version you like. It's fine. This is ESV though. And it says this: when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, pleading with him, saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed, dreadfully tormented. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. Pause. Notice how the servant doesn't say, Jesus, come and heal my servant. He just presents his condition to Jesus and trusts that Jesus knows what to do. I will come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word. Funny, we're talking about the power of in his name and how it's not just a name, it's the power in his name and the authority that he has. But only speak a word and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. He understood Jesus' authority. When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to those who followed, assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. And I say to you that many will come from east and west, so he's referring to the Gentiles, people outside of Israel, and I'll sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of the kingdom will be cast into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go your way, as you have believed, so let it be done for you. And his servant was healed that same hour. What a great passage, right? Yeah. I think if Jesus is saying, you know, I haven't seen faith like this in all of Israel, and he is marveled by this man's faith, I think his faith is worth paying attention to. I want to have a look at what this passage and what other portions of scripture in the Bible say about placing priority on our faith and what that should look like. And I want to preface this by saying as well that this has really, really been a challenging word for me, because it's been convicting me and speaking to me first. This is something that I'm going to share a bit of my testimony a bit later on, but I really do feel like this has been a word that has been pretty much my life lessons over the past 6 months into a word. So this is something that the Lord has really been teaching me and convicting me on. So I pray that it speaks to you as well. But the first point, urgent faith always begins with recognition of your condition. So the centurion understood his condition by understanding Jesus's position. You know, the first time that I preached, I spoke about acknowledging Jesus and why it's so important that we acknowledge who he is in our lives, that we acknowledge that he's not just our Savior, but he's our Lord, he's our King. And the centurion recognized this. He said, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word and my servant will be healed. See, we will become desperately urgent about our faith the more dependent we are on Jesus. You know, I was in my lounge room the other day just spending some time with the Lord, and he said to me, Cass, you take care of yourself too much. And I was like, Lord, are you sure about that? Because my pantry's not usually well stocked and I usually have lots of laundry to do. And he goes, no, actually, emotionally, you got your own back too much and you're not letting me have room to have your back. And I really felt him say, self-reliance is the suffocation of our faith. When we become so self-reliant that there's actually no space to be dependent and reliant on Jesus. If your cupboard and your fridge is stocked with food, you're not going to feel the urgent need to run to Woolies or Coles, right? But if you have one packet of Mee Goreng and one can of Coke Zero that's been in there for 6 months, yes, I'm speaking from personal experience. Amen. You will be desperate for Coles. Amen, amen, amen. Recently, I got a job at Coles, by the way. I have developed a new nickname there. Not sure if I like it. I was laughing. Oh, can I tell you something really quick? Nothing to do with anything. I was filling shelves last night at Coles, and I'm in the dairy aisle, and I've got like this, you know, 2 litre tub of Neapolitan ice cream, and I'm loading it. And I had this weird thought, because I've got this nickname at Coles now, right? They call me the Dairy Queen, because I fill the frozen aisles and the fridges. Don't know how I feel about that. Yeah, I know Pastor Kira loves it. I don't know how I feel about it. But I'm filling these shelves and I'm putting this ice cream out and I'm going, how weird. Like, I'm in like these safety gear boots getting called the Dairy Queen, lifting 2 litre ice cream, and tomorrow afternoon I'm going to be preaching at my church. Life is weird, but it's amazing, right? It's amazing. Oh, don't you dare. Don't you dare. Someone kick him out. No, I'm joking. You may call me Dairy Queen if you like. I'd prefer Cass, but I'll allow it because I love you all so much. All right, back on topic. If I have one packet of mee goreng and one can of Coke, I'm going to be desperate to go to the shops. We need to be desperate for Jesus. We will place the highest value on our faith the more desperate we are for him. But the more we know how to take care of ourselves and we think that our condition is without him, the lower on our priority list that it will go. Especially when you're relying on yourself for the fruits of the Spirit in your life, which we all do. When you rely on yourself for your own joy, on yourself for your own peace, those things, if you rely on yourself, will be temporary, but if you rely on Jesus, they'll be eternal. And if we want any idea of what our condition is, we can find it in Scripture time and time again. I'm just going to throw some at you. Romans 5:8, but God demonstrated his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Ephesians 2:8-9, for by grace you have been saved through faith and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. And 1 Peter 2:24, and he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross that we might die to sin and live to righteousness, for by his wounds you were healed. And that's just like a handful of a multitude of scriptures that tell us just how much we need Jesus' hand on our lives. See, and this is where I got this a little bit backwards, because I always used to think, okay, if I have urgent faith or if I'm putting priority on my faith, that means I need to be doing more stuff, right? If it's number one, then I'll do the most for it. But that's actually not the case, and I think that's a lie that a lot of us can believe. It's actually not about doing more, but allowing him to do more in you. Because if you just try and do more, you will get exhausted, tired, discouraged, burnt out. But if you make space, you know, Ben spoke a great message on Thursday night at Young Adults about the glory of God and how we need to make room for God if we want to see his glory. And that's exactly right. If we want to put value on our faith, we need to be making space for him to move. We need to be acknowledging and allowing more of him in our lives through us and less of us. So in a way, it's actually really encouraging because it actually requires less of you than you think. It actually just requires you making more room for him. You know, even in that, Pastor Kira did a great message on all the times in the Gospels where it was said, oh, you of little faith. And I think it's the time that he says it in Mark, of you, oh, you of little faith, that he couldn't do any miracles there. He could only do a few healings. And you think, for us, a Sunday morning, if, you know, just a few healings happened, a couple of people got delivered, we'd be like, whoa, that's insane. But Jesus was like, oh, they had a little bit of faith, so I can only do a few healings. It actually doesn't require that much of us. It actually just requires us getting out of the way for him to move. So urgent faith begins with recognition of your condition. I'm going to power through these. Urgent faith surrenders to authority. So once we've recognized our need for Jesus, our desperate need for Jesus, that urgency will continue to develop through our ability to surrender to his authority. You know, I was listening to a message the other week and I was weary of whether or not I wanted to share this because it's pretty full on, but it wasn't me who said it, so I can. This person said, Satan dines on whatever we withhold from the Lord. That's why I felt so strongly to speak on acknowledging Jesus in my last message, because whatever we, don't be surprised that any area that you withhold from God, that you won't bring under his authority, that is the very area that you will find is attacked the most and is the weakest. You know, and this is where I'd love to share a bit of personal experience for me. It was maybe my whole life I've struggled a lot with my identity, with my security within myself, with feeling like I'm not good enough. And I think a lot of people can really relate to that. Just feeling like I've got to get everything right in order for it to be good, perfectionist mentality, all this sort of thing. Really struggled with it. And it was one of those things that I never put urgency on dealing with it. You know, it would be like, oh, I'll try and deal with it. And then I kind of push it away. So anyway, it got to the point last year where I said to myself, and godly people around me said this as well, it is not doable to live like this anymore. And I got to this point where I thought, I cannot continue living my life with these poisonous and toxic mentalities. And I believe God's going to, actually, the power of the Holy Spirit is going to break some of those toxic lies that some of you are believing this afternoon. But I really, yeah, believed that I wasn't good enough. So what did I do? I decided towards the end of last year that I would take a week off of church, of life, of everything, to really think about things and sort things out. And in typical me fashion, I spent the first 2 days going, cool, how am I going to fix myself? How shall I fix myself? You know, I actually, this is not a joke. This is just how maybe nerdy and incomprehensible I am. I got out a notepad and I tried to write like a pros and cons list about myself. I don't know what I thought that would achieve, because the pros list was like one thing and then the cons list, they didn't have enough room on the page. And I was like, this is just terrible. So anyway, it got to midway during the week. It was the Wednesday and I was like, oh, this is getting worse, not better, not good, not good. So at the time I was Uber driving. Is this all right? Yeah. It's all right? Are you with me? Good. So I was Uber driving and a really bad night. Look, if you want to Uber drive, do it. I would never do it again, praise Jesus. So I finished, it was like 8:30 and I was like, still midway during the week, nothing had changed in my life. And I was like, okay, I'm just going to live like this. And how often do we get to that point where we think, oh, I've tried everything. I guess this is just it. This is just how I'm supposed to live. And it's just not the case. God has more for you this afternoon. A lot more for you. So I'm driving in the car and I was like, I guess I'll put some worship music on to see what happens. I'll just put it on, whatever. So I put on some worship music. I'm driving home. And for the first time in my entire life, I heard the audible voice of God. Never happened to me in my whole life, but I actually felt like Jesus was in the passenger seat. It was that clear and that loud. And do you know what he said to me? In all love and in all kindness, but it's what I needed to hear. He said, Cass, you've robbed me for too long. I want you to stop. So I was like, okay. So I'm like bawling my eyes out, pull over, crying. And I asked the Lord, what do you mean? And he said, you're great at giving me the stuff you do, your job, your money, but I actually don't have all of you. I actually want you, your identity. You haven't surrendered that to me. And then you wonder why that's an area that the enemy always has a foothold in your life, always making you feel secure, because you actually haven't surrendered yourself, your identity, who you are, to me. So that was the turning point for me. I went home, spent 4 hours on my carpet crying. It was good times. Thanks, Matt. Appreciate the laugh. But anyway, yeah, so and then I really just spent the last few days just with this big release of like, God, I don't have to control how I'm perceived by people. I don't have to control. I just have to submit to you. Because what submission does is it's actually your protection. That's why God places godly authority in our lives, because when we submit to that, we're protected and we're covered. That's the way that he likes to do things. James 4 verse 7 says, therefore submit to God, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Surrender and submission is our tool of resistance against the enemy, because whatever we surrender, he cannot touch. But if it is out in the open for him, he will take it. If you're being attacked, if your family is being attacked, submit your family to the Lord again. If your home is being attacked, submit your home to the Lord again. If your finances are being attacked, submit your finances to the Lord again. It's encouraging because it is for your own protection. It's because he loves you that he's saying, hey, give that to me. Give that to me. I'll hold it for you, because I can, in my hand, it's much safer than in yours. And I think that's something that we need to learn. And another cool thing is that when you start the process of resisting, so first you recognize your condition, then you surrender to his authority. Then once you've surrendered, that's the starting process of resistance. And I was looking at the armor of God. You know, there are 5 elements of the armor of God. There's the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, shield of faith, belt of truth. There's six things, shoes of good news, and the sword of the Spirit. But what God revealed to me is that five elements of those are defensive. One element is offensive, because the sword of the Spirit is the only thing you need to fight against the enemy. You can strategize however you want to strategize, but the Lord knows that you need five things to protect your flesh, but you only need the sword of the Spirit to fight against the enemy's schemes. We need the Spirit of God. So urgent faith. Is this good? Is everyone with me? Beautiful. Urgent faith begins with recognition of your condition. It continues when you surrender to authority. And urgent faith is real and visible, but it also has to believe before it sees. See, faith is not abstract. I think sometimes when our faith gets a bit lower on the priority list, it starts to become less real and tangible and more like this up in the sky thing that we can't really conceive. Like it's a part of our life, but we can't like touch the ground with it. And I think faith is meant to produce fruit. We're meant to see it, but at the same time, we're meant to believe it before we see it. That's the right order. The centurion said to Jesus, "But speak a word." He recognized that the authority of Jesus wasn't some mystical concept, but that what Jesus spoke had authority and power. Faith believes in the authority of Jesus before it believes for an outcome. Thomas is a great example of this. He needed to touch Jesus' wounds to be convinced that he was resurrected. In John 20:29, Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Faith believes in who Jesus is before what he can do. See, some of us believe in the promises of God before we believe in the God of the promise. We believe in the things that he said he's going to do for us, and the things that he said he's going to give us, and the ways that he said he's going to provide for us, more than we actually believe in him and who he is. See, Moses is a great example of this. He goes up to Mount Sinai, and he receives all the instruction from the Lord, all the download of how they're going to live as a people, all their rules, all their regulations, all the bits. And he comes down, and the people have done it again. They built a golden calf to worship. And so he has to do what he's done chapters and chapters before, which is intercede for the people. "Lord, don't destroy them. Please take them into the promised land." And he's sort of having this dialogue with the Lord. And in Exodus 33:15, he says, "And he said to him," this is Moses to the Lord, and this is, I've read this verse every day for about the last 6 months because I love it. "If your presence will not go with me, do not bring us up from here." You see, it's not about a destination, it's about the presence in the destination. It's about who God is in the process. And if you're following God with the expectation that you're going to get somewhere, the hard part about it is his ways are higher than our ways. So that might not always look like how you think it's going to look. It might look very different to how you perceive. But if you can put your ultimate trust in who God is over what he says, you will always be content. You will always be satisfied. You will not be unwavering. And you will always place priority on your faith over everything else, because you're believing before you see it. God, if I have nothing, and honestly, like, it's hard to conceive, and I don't know if I would actually be like this, but I would love to get to a point where I could literally say, "God, if I have nothing and I have you, it's enough." And we say it all the time, but I want it to be real for me. I want it to be absolutely, deeply, deeply real for me, that I could literally have nothing and he would literally be everything that I need. I want that to be a reality. Urgent faith takes responsibility. Galatians 6:4-5. "But let each one test his own work, and then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor, for each will have to bear his own load." We have to take responsibility for our own faith. We can't rely on the faith of other people. And we've all done it, and I've done it before as well. In times where I felt really insecure about myself or unsure, I'll just wait till the Sunday to kind of get my fix, because I'm not really in a place to seek after it in my own time. But that is not sustainable. And that will not grow your faith, and that will not put urgency on your faith. We all need to take responsibility for our own faith, because your faith is personal, because it's about relationship between you and God. You know, we say it's not about religion, it's about relationship, but then we treat it like religion because we only give it attention in the confines of our traditional structures, and it doesn't flow into our everyday life. We're the ones who treat it like religion, But it is about relationship, and if we want it to be about relationship, we will put urgency on it and we will desperately seek the face of Jesus every day, not just in these four buildings, not just at a prayer meeting or at a worship night. We will do it consistently and because we love him, not because of an outcome, because we're taking responsibility for our relationship. Whew, it's good, good, good. Worship team, you can start to make your way up. I don't know how long I'll be. It could be 5 minutes, could be 20 minutes. I don't know. We'll see. Urgent faith is others focused. It's others focused. The centurion could have asked Jesus to clear his name because the Romans and the Jews didn't get along. He could have asked him to declare him righteous among the Jews, to come into his house to demonstrate that he had a relationship with him. But he was concerned for the needs of his servant first. Philippians 2, 3 and 4, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others. This is where I'm going to say something that the Lord really convicted me on. But the interesting thing about that scripture is it says, let each of you look out for the interests of others, not the affairs of others. Not the affairs of others. We are not called to know one another's business or to have information on one another's lives. It says the interests of others. So what's going to better you? I want to know about that so I can help you. What are you interested in? What are you passionate about? What are you called to? Let me know so I can push you forward. As a brother and sister in Christ, if I am saying things about you to know your affairs, to talk about them, that's not what the scripture is saying. That's self-indulgence. That's not selflessness. Selflessness is not about the affairs of others. It's about the interests of others, to grow one another, to push one another closer to Jesus, not to talk for talking's sake. You know, I was meeting with a lady once, awesome counselor, awesome lady, Christian lady, and she said to me, you know, as Christians, think of it like a big, we're all in our ships. We're a big fleet of ships, right? But so often as Christians, we're the salesmen that are leaning over, looking at the barnacles and all the dirt on other people's boat, not realizing that we've got our own broken mast, an oar that doesn't even work, that's eroding, a crew that aren't even doing their job on deck. We get so concerned with what other people are doing. It says this is why taking responsibility is so important. You see, that's good. Urgent faith focusing on others means being quick to acknowledge our own shortcomings first, because that's our responsibility. And then through that, because we've worked on ourselves, worked on our own shortcomings, now we are in a position to help other people. Once we have worked on ourselves, once we have brought our cynicism, our hurt, our pain, our brokenness before the Lord, allowed him to heal that first, now we are in a healthy place to look at the interests of others. Does that make sense? And then last point, and then I want to share a vision that God gave me, and then we're going to pray. But so urgent faith begins with the recognition of your condition. It continues through surrender to authority. Urgent faith is real and visible, but also believes before it sees. Urgent faith takes responsibility. Urgent faith focuses on others. And urgent faith will solidify. This is how it sticks. Through a continuous building of our history and relationship with God. See, some of us know God, but don't feel like we ever progress in our faith, because we're not building our own personal history with him. See, I call him Jehovah Jireh because he's always been Jehovah Jireh, because that's my history with him. I call him the God of love because I've experienced his love time and time again, and that's why I know who he is. That's my history with him. But you cannot rely on somebody else's history with him. What's your history with God? Who's he been to you? And if all he's been is a name in a church, I believe he wants to be more than that with you this afternoon. To push you forward into that urgency, to put priority on your faith once again, to make it your one and only once again. I don't want Jesus to just be a name in a church. I want him to be the thing that moves me, the person I love the most, the God that came and died for me. I want it to fill me with so much passion. Like Jeremiah said, it's like a fire in my bones. I'm trying to shut it up, but I can't. I want that passion, that zeal again. I don't just want to come here week to week and it just be another thing. I want to build my relationship with Jesus, but it takes discipline and time, and it takes sacrifice. And so I want to ask the question, are you really willing to sacrifice it all for the one who sacrificed everything for you? Are you willing? Because if you are, it will change your whole life. I really believe that there are people in this room that need to put an urgency on their faith again. And God is reaching out to you right now. You know, I got a picture. I was driving in the car this afternoon on my way here, and I got a picture of people's hearts. And in them was something. For some people, it was a shot glass because it's alcohol. Some people's, it was a cigarette. Some people, it was parents because you've been hurt by your parents. Whatever is that thing. And then I saw a picture of yourself. I saw a picture of people. And it was so vivid. It was people stepping backwards. And as they were stepping backwards, the further away they got from Jesus, they were pouring concrete onto their hearts. Concrete over that thing. And the further back they got, the more the concrete started to harden and solidify around that thing. And I believe there are people in here this afternoon that you've just got concrete around your heart. And the Holy Spirit is wanting to invade your life this afternoon and break it, because that's His power, and fill you from head to toe with His peace and with His love. But it actually takes a step of you putting your pride to the side of what you might look like. Because at the end of the day, those things that we put concrete around, they won't matter. They're not eternal. And it's heavy, and it's an intense thing to say, but these things that we become so consumed by, these trivial things, not urgent. We become so consumed, so discouraged. And we get to a point where we're so used to being out of relationship with God, we no longer desire being in it. You know, we're gonna worship, because that's what we do. But I want to encourage you all this afternoon. Please, 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 if you can hear one thing from what I'm saying and you forget the rest, you forget everything I've said, you don't remember a thing of my message, that does not bother me. But if you can catch one thing, get your passion and your urgency for your faith back. Get it back. The enemy stole that from me for too long, and I got it back, and you can get it back too. You can get it back. Amen. But it requires an element of surrender and vulnerability. And I want to encourage you, if you're ready to do that, I would love the opportunity to pray with you. I'm going to be up here. I'm going to be ready. But I really believe that there are people here that need to do this afternoon, and this is your opportunity. So why don't you stand? Thank you, Jesus. God, I pray this afternoon that you would begin to soften people's hearts. God, if there are areas in our lives where that are preventing us from being urgent and passionate about you, that you would just break those things down, that we would be able to be vulnerable with you, to put our pride to the side, to come to you and say, Jesus, we need you. Jesus, we love you. We can't do anything apart from you. And God, I pray this afternoon that where there have been strongholds over people's lives, that you would break them in the name of Jesus, that there would continue to be an urgency and a stirring to put you first, to seek first the kingdom, and then everything else gets added. But it's your kingdom first, Jesus. It's your kingdom first, Jesus. Thank you, Father. The team are going to lead us in worship, but I want to encourage you. If you want to make your faith urgent again, if you feel like you've lost a bit of that and you want it back, I want to encourage you, come down the front. I'd love to pray with you.
Only for you. Take my heart
as a sacrifice. I want to bless you.
Open up the altar now if you want prayer. Come on. This is a time where the Spirit can lead. We're going to lay hands. Be the active church we are. Let's go. Come on.
You're moving on.
defeat, every thought of discouragement, every thought of complacency, in the name of Jesus, the Lord rebuke those demonic, those evil thoughts. He is worthy of our sacrifice, whether it's embarrassing or whether it's not. He is worthy of our energy, whether we have some or not. Church. Jesus invites us to eat with him. He invites us to sit at his table. Let us not sit in the corner and cry about being hungry when he has called us to his table. And Father, right now I ask that you would open eyes, that you would soften hearts to see how good of a God you are, how much you want us at the table, how much you want to commune with us, how much you want to sit with us. And in Jesus' name, every lie of the enemy would be broken. Every tactic of the enemy, the Lord rebuke you. You have no power here. You have no authority here. You have no truth here. And so in the name of Jesus, right now, Holy Spirit, would you open eyes, would you soften hearts, and would you draw us near so tenderly, so kindly, as such a good, good Father that you are. Would you draw us near? Would we be drawn near to you this evening, that we would not be able to withhold from you, that we would not be able to withhold from what you have for us, Father, but that we would lay ourselves down at your table, that we would be fed by you, Lord, that we would be rejuvenated by you, that we would be strengthened by you. If you need to sit at the table of the Lord, come forward. Because when we show God how desperate we are, he does not withhold from us. He never withholds from us. But it is not the truth that he wouldn't give us what we need. And that is a lie that has been broken today. Do not believe the lie of the enemy that God does not give us what we need. He responds to our sacrifice and he responds to our desperate hearts. So if that's you, you're not showing anyone but God what your desire is. So Father, I pray that you would fall, that you would move upon and through our hearts, Lord. And we're going to worship him some more. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus.
Lord, that I adore is in you.
Come on, church, why don't you give him your heart?
Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul, I live for you alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm away, Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me.
Holy Spirit is doing mighty things here. Mighty things. Jesus. There is a... I want to release a vision that's just been brought, that the Lord has released. Brother Mike. Brother Mike just shared a vision with me. I believe it's pertaining. The Spirit is wanting to move and he's released something. Please release it to the church.
Following Cass's message about the heart, I had a vision, and the vision that I got was each person's heart is a house. And when we first come to Christ, we open the door to the front of the house, the entrance, and we let him walk in. But in the house, in our heart, there are areas that we don't want to allow Jesus in, whether they're painful or too hard to face. Some rooms we're quite happy to allow him to go in there, but we have the key, and the key, I think, is humbling ourselves and submitting to him. And you know, we open the door and let him in, and then you know, he's the one that comes in and puts it in order and stuff. So I just encourage people, don't be ashamed of the clutter or the stuff that you're holding in these rooms. Just if you can have the courage to hand the keys over to Jesus and say, look, Jesus, open this door, whether it's a door of fear, if it's doubt, or if it's anxiety, or whatever's in your heart that you are holding on to. I believe Jesus wants to grab those keys and he wants to open these doors, because then he can have full reign of your heart, and you and him can enjoy your house. But if there's areas that are hidden from him, he can't fully enjoy your heart or your house as much as what he wants to.
Thank you, Jesus. I give you my soul. Everything in and out, every moment. Take it, Lord Jesus.
Have your way.
Lord, I give you. Lord, I. This is a prayer to be prayed.
In my soul.
Bypass the lyrics.
I live for you. And every breath that I take. Every moment I'm awake, I to worship and to worship you. I live to worship you, and I live to worship you. Let the rain of his glory fill the house, and to worship.
Take it, Lord. Take it, Lord.
To worship you, I live to worship you.
said, oh.
Cooking, let's go.
I got a sense just before we end the service, I feel like there's a, the Lord is just stirring my heart saying there is a breakthrough that the Lord has wanted a breakthrough, and I think it's just come through all different ways and shapes and forms tonight. Through Cass's word, Kira preaching, us worshipping, I have the word of the Lord in my head just going, there's like a chain, a link of change, and I feel like the Lord's saying he's want to sever something tonight. And as we've been worshiping, this like resonance in my heart. The Lord's saying, you know, I could do it, but sometimes they got to release it. And even through Mike's word, just like we've got, you know, the house and it's our house, but now we've got to open up doors to let him in. And I think there's an element of self-responsibility taking place tonight, because even Cass's message was just, if you want to sum it up in one sentence, self-responsibility in your faith. And so I just have a sense in my heart right now, the Lord is wanting to break something. So, this is what we're going to do. I'm going to count to three. To worship you, I live. We're going to build. When I count to three, every single person in this auditorium, oh man, I can sense something's going to just take place. I can feel it in my spirit. Hear me out, hear me out, hear me out. We're going to build, okay? And I can see like Paul, like fire just sitting on you in the spirit. I can see it. When you hit the drums, we're going to build. We're going to sing To Worship You, I Live in a second. We're not going to sing the lyrics. You guys are going to play it. We're going to, this side of the street's going to do something else. But when we do, you guys just absolutely build. Paul, release breakthrough power through those drums like there's no tomorrow. You hear me? Cool. This side of the auditorium, when I count to three, we're going to worship on this side. And on this side, you're going to speak in the spirit so absolutely mental loud that something's going to shift and break in this spirit realm. I believe it. I believe it. You know I don't do this very often, but this is something right now. I know it. I know it and I know it. Are you with me? I tell you right now, church, 7 days ago from this day, I saw some significant signs and wonders that I cannot articulate with my mouth. And I just want it in this house. And I believe tonight starts. Are you ready? Good. One. Two. Let's go. Three. Watch, build it, let's go. If you've got that voice, let it rise. Breakthrough. Fire of the Holy Ghost, rest on your people now. That's it, hands are up everywhere, let's go! I'm losing my voice. Let's go.
Seated on his throne, he was clothed in glory, exalted high.
Train of his robe, let it fill this house.
And the train of his throne,
fill the temple, Lord.
Fills the temple, and the angels circle around him, and they cry.
Church, let's adore him. Let's just love him.
For they cry,
Jesus, you are You are, you are, you are, you are. Jesus.
Oh, so.
Jesus. Jesus. Come for church, I came for revival. Came for a move of the Spirit of God. And God is doing something here. You have to be a rocket scientist to see what's going on. I sense in my spirit, and this is just, well, this was already abstract enough as it is, so let's just keep going. I sense in my spirit, and it's a bit odd, but I just want to be obedient. I want to call up a friend of mine because I just sensed in my heart that there's something for him to release, and I think I just got to be obedient.
Can we just close our eyes and lift up our hands to heaven? Give me 2 minutes. Give me 2 minutes. Lift up your hands. God is in this place. Jesse, quickly, come on. Stand here. touch where I just touched that with the oil. Just walk slowly and just try to touch that. Just keep on touching that. Stay there, stay there. Keep on touching that. Anointing, just come up to the front as close as you can to that part of the stage. Holy, holy, holy. Come on, bro. My Lord. Holy, come on, take a step with me. Holy, holy. Paul, come here quickly. The stage and you'll get healed right now, right now, right now.
Holy Spirit. Jesus, I just want to be in your presence so deep. Right at the throne of your glory. Father, we prayed for revival. Father, I pray that your Spirit would fall upon each one of us, a deeper sense of your glory, that we wouldn't just hear or think of, we sensed you. I want to feel you, Lord. We want to feel you, Lord. Holy Spirit, your anointing, the anointing that is the very thing that breaks bondages and loosens and heals and sets free. Father, I pray a blessing over everyone. Bless our coming and our going. Bless this week, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. If you want to go, by all means, please be blessed. Have a phenomenal week. For those of you that want to stay and keep praying, I'm not going to let this moment pass me by. Have a great week. We love you. We'll see you next week. God bless.